that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Let's worship him this morning. Be seated. I want us to take some time to confess sin together. Psalm 110 is also quoted in the book of Hebrews when it references Melchizedek. In the psalm, it promises that there would be a priest coming from the order of Melchizedek. And there's a lot of ink spilled on what exactly that means by commentators. But there's a chapter in Hebrews, and I'm not going to dig into all the details. But what we can know is that the priest that comes through the order of Melchizedek, who is Jesus, is different than the normal line of priests. And he's different because he's a priest who is forever. He is a priest who is a promise, is what it says, a better covenant, a better way, and a better hope. And it asks a question. The author of Hebrews asks a question, verse 11, and I'm gonna pose that question to us now and have us consider why there needed to be a priest at all, but especially a different kind of priest with a better hope and a better promise. Here's the question. Now, if perfection had been attainable through the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need would there have been for another priest to arrive after the order of Melchizedek rather than one named after the order of Aaron? And the answer, in part, is because we could not, like God's people in the Old Testament, we could not, would not be obedient to the law, which was grace in and of itself. The people of God, even though shown grace and love and mercy through the law, refused to obey the law. And so he sent a new priest, an eternal priest, with a better covenant and a better way, And that was through his own death. He was the sacrifice. He was the perfect Israelite on our behalf. And in order for that to be applied, we have to confess. We have to start by saying, I'm sorry that I have not kept the law. I have not been holy. Knowing that because of Jesus, we are forgiven. So let's take a moment and we'll sing a song that will be part of our confession, considering the cross of Christ as being necessary because of our sin, just like those in the Old Testament. Let's take a moment in silence. Allow the Spirit to show us areas to confess. Father, we thank you that you are here with us among your people. You have not turned away from us. Lord, you see, you are not blind to the truth that we love your creation, we love your gifts more than we love you. We love the things that give us temporary, vain satisfaction more than we love the joy of your presence. And we love ourselves more than we love others. And you know this, you see it, you hear it on our lips, see into our hearts, and you forgive us. You welcome us into your presence. You take pleasure when we gather together, lifting up the name of our high priest, Jesus. So in his name we say together, amen, amen. Let's stand and worship together.
Amen. As Mark's words implied earlier, it would be wrong to think of the people of Israel and under the old covenant needing a priest, but Christians under the new covenant not needing a priest. The reality is that we still need a priest, and we also still need a sacrifice. What's amazing about Jesus being our high priest in the order of Melchizedek, or at least one of the amazing things, is that he, the priest, is also the sacrifice. Amen?
Amen.
Listen to these words and hear them as the assurance of pardon for those of you who have come to the Lord in contrition and confess your sins. The book of Hebrews chapter 7, it says, "For it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He has no need, like those high priests, to offer sacrifices daily, first for his own sins and then for those of the people, since he did this once for all when he offered up himself." Brothers and sisters, the priesthood of Jesus is one where the priest doesn't have to offer many sacrifices. He offers one, himself, and the people are pure as a result forever and ever. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. At this time, I'm going to ask my wife if she would read Psalm 110. As Mark mentioned, the most quoted psalm in the New Testament. In fact, I believe it's the most quoted chapter in the New Testament, and it talks about Jesus's being both king and priest.
Psalm 110. The Lord says to my Lord, "Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. Rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power in holy garments. From the womb of the morning, the dew of your youth will be yours. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever, after the order of Melchizedek. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings on the day of his wrath. He will execute judgment among the nations, filling them with corpse. He will shatter chiefs over the wide earth. He will drink from the brook by the way. Therefore, he will lift up his head.
Ready? One, two, three, four.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. You are
Yes, you are, yes, you are, yes, you are. So good, so good. Yes, you are, yes, you are, yes, you are. Yes, you are.
Church, God is good
all the time.
God, we thank you that you are good, even sometimes when we don't understand it. We don't understand you and the way you do things, but we know and we can trust that you are good and that you are for us. You are for your people. And all God's people said together, amen, amen. You may be seated. So I want to welcome you to Midtown Church, to worshiping together here. I'm glad you're here. I'm Mark Tucker on staff with my brother Aaron Turner, who is bringing us God's word from Deuteronomy today. And I just want to say, as we say every week, that there is stuff for you on the table back there. There are books, there are animal crackers, there are cookies, there's coffee, and there's tea, just as a way to say thank you for coming. Thank you, and enjoy your time of worship with us today. We are going to have a time of prayer here in a moment, and then Brittany, is going to come and share a little bit about ministry at Harris Stowe. So Chad is going to pray after, no, first we're going to do, yeah, Brittany's going to share, and then Chad's going to pray. But I was going to say one thing to add to your prayer list, Chad, and that's to pray for Allie Green. Hey, Allie, can you raise your hand? She's here and used to be a part of our church. Graduate of Harris Stowe, and then the Lord called her to the East Coast where she is studying go into ministry at Westminster Seminary, right? And how much longer do you have, Allie? Okay, so a little less than a year. So we want to just add her to the prayer list, and it's good to see you. Thanks for coming and worshiping with us today. It's good to see you. So with that in mind, Brittany, would you come and share a little bit? You and Jada both? Yeah. Yeah. And while they're sharing, we're going to take up offering as a part of the way that we give back to the Lord.
While I'm talking, that's fine. Hello, good morning. Like Mark said, my name is Brittany, and this is my friend Jada.
Hi, guys.
I work for Crew at Harris Stowe, and so I'm going to be sharing a little bit just about what the Lord has been up to. And Jada is up here because we recently had a big conference that we do every year called Winter Conference, where we go to Indianapolis, and there are some really awesome speakers and seminars and worship and just a time that students are able to grow in their faith and connect with the Lord. And I thought better for her to share her own experience than for me to tell you about her experience. And so Jada came to Winter Conference with us. And so first I would love, for you guys to just hear a little bit about like what the Lord has been up to in Jada's life and what he did in her life at Winter Conference.
Hey guys. I go to Harrisville State University and I'm a communications major and I just joined CREW like last semester. God has really been working in my life, like really last year. I was just really trying to understand like who God really was, because like I don't think I've never knew, like I didn't really have like a good understanding of like who he was. I've always grown up as a Christian. Like I was just told I was a Christian, but my mom didn't really explain what that meant to me. She didn't really talk about it to me. So I found myself coming to college and like really like finding him for myself when times were really, really hard. And then my good friend Kira in the back, she introduced me to CREW. And I have really just enjoyed the community and the way I've been able to just ask questions and not feel judged for not understanding. And it just all started to make more sense to me. And then I decided, Emily, she's not here, but she took me down to Winter Conference. And I just knew leading up to the beginning of the year, because it was like going into the new year, I just knew there was like this change that was going to happen. Like I felt it in my gut, like things weren't going to be the same after the new year. I just didn't understand like how. And so I kept on telling myself, like, I need to prepare, I need to plan, like, this is my year, you know? And so I hadn't did any of that. I went to Winter Conference, and I was just surrounded by, like, the Holy Spirit. Every time any of the speakers, because we had speakers there, anytime they were speaking, I would begin to ask God, like, look, because I don't think I've really ever asked him, like, what my calling was. Like, I never really asked him. I always just kind of thought I knew what I was supposed to be doing. And so I'm like, okay, maybe God, could you just tell me, like, what is it that you're calling me to do? And every time that I would talk to him and ask him to, like, reveal to me something, he would do it every single time. And my faith was kind of little because I didn't really believe in the whole Jesus thing just yet. I didn't really have the confidence just yet like I do now. And so I would ask him, like, okay, God, you told me this, but, like, I'll ask again, like, God, are you sure this is what you're telling me? And so throughout the experience, he kind of had just told me that I was supposed to be spreading the word of gospel to other people, because I feel like it was unfair that other people aren't able to experience this goodness that I've been able to. And it's like, it's pretty wild that people haven't heard about him and who didn't know about him, because I didn't for so long. So I thought I would be honored to kind of like take that on. And so, yeah, he just was really comforting me the whole time. Like, one of the speakers was just like, you know, if you have a friend who's looking to go into full-time ministry, support them, right? And so during one of the sessions, St. Louis CREW had got together, because we kind of like did some debriefing, and I went up there and tell my testimony. I'm like, guys, I'm telling you guys because I want you guys to hold me accountable. If I don't, because I haven't talked to anybody about what I had been experiencing. And I'm like, if I said to you all, maybe I can be held accountable. And so afterwards, one of my friends had came up and was like, look, I was thinking about going to a mission trip. And she was just like, well, you know how the lady, she was talking about, if anybody wants to go into full-time ministry, support them. She was like, I may be having a little bit extra funds to get to, for myself to go on a mission trip. Maybe I can help you go as well. So that was just more confirmation to me that this was something that God was wanting me to do. And ever since then, like this whole month, like I can say this is my first full month of really being confident in God. And he has really been good to me. I've never felt so good in my life. I've never been able to handle situations the way I've been able to handle them. And God is good. He's really been teaching me, and I've really just been on this trust journey with him. And It's been challenging. It's definitely been challenging, but God is good.
Amen. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks so much. So fun. Yeah, the Lord is up to a lot at Harris Stowe, for real. Like, me and Emily and Aaron a couple times have been like, man, like, it really feels like there's a revival happening. Like, so many students are getting to know who Jesus really is for the first time. We have so many students in our group who just truly are, like, on fire. Like, they just have this huge light inside of them, like Jada and so many others, like, just this huge light that is beaming out of them for just a desire and a longing to want to get to know Jesus and, like, want to know more about who God is and want to live their lives for the Lord. And they have so many questions. And we sit in Bible study, and Aaron just spends the majority of our Bible study answering all kinds of questions that students come, like, ready with. Like, they're just so eager to know, like, who is God and what does this have to do with me and how can I live my life for the Lord? And so it's been really sweet and really fun. We had several other students come to Winter Conference with us as well, and coming back, they all just had a really positive, incredible experience where they all truly encountered the Lord in some way while they were at Winter Conference, which is just a really beautiful, amazing thing that they had that opportunity and that we get to walk alongside them in that opportunity. Yeah, so it's been really cool. There are tons of stories that I could tell you about what the Lord has been doing in the lives of Harris Stowe students. I wanted to share a little bit. Last time I shared, if any of you remember, I shared about a student at Harris Stowe that around this time last year, she had first started coming to, she came to one of our events on campus, and we didn't see her again for a while. She was the roommate of a student that had been coming regularly, and then she decided to go to New Orleans with us that year, having not really known any of us. She just came, and she had a really good time, and while she was there, she had told us that being in New Orleans with Crew was really redefining for her what Christianity was and who God was and who Christians were. Just a really powerful time for her. And so over the rest of that semester and then over the fall semester this year, she spent a lot of time just learning and growing and getting to know more about who God is and what the gospel is. And she graduated in December, but I can confidently say that as she was leaving, like, she had a relationship with Jesus. She had trusted the Lord. She had surrendered her life to the Lord. And last time I shared, she wasn't there yet. She was still learning. She wasn't quite ready, but she really obviously started to change her language from "I'm not there yet" to, like, "Yeah, I'm in. Like, I'm in for this Christian thing. I'm in for this Jesus thing. Like, this is real." She would say things to me like, "Brittany, the more that I read in the Bible, like, the more things that I am knowing and learning, like, the more and more real all of this is to me. Like, the more clearly and obviously this is real, you know, like, it just makes sense." And I'm like, "Yeah, like, it's, of course it does. Like, it is real, you know, it's very real." And so, praise the Lord, like, a student like her, we don't have her in our movement anymore, but just trusting and praying that the Lord is going to continue just blossoming her relationship with him. But we got to see her really trust Christ before she left, which is really amazing. Yeah. A couple things that you guys can be praying for. This month we have a couple kind of bigger, not our typical Bible study that we're going to be doing. And so this upcoming week on Tuesday, we're going to have our Tough Questions Night. And so Pastor Mark and some other people are going to come and they're going to answer Harris Stowe students' toughest questions about God, the Bible, Christianity. And so we're going to be set up and we're going to have them on a panel. During the day, we're going to be handing out some donuts and gathering questions from students, and they're just going to get some answers to some of their harder questions. And so be praying for that event, be praying for our panelists, that they would come prepared with good answers, but also just the Holy Spirit would be fully ready to meet students in some really difficult topics and questions. And then later this month, we have Vince Bantu that's coming Some of you might know who he is. He's good friends with Aaron. He just is an incredible pastor and leader and very wise about a lot of things. And he's going to be coming and talking to our Harris Stowe students about, is Christianity the white man's religion, which is a really big topic at Harris Stowe. And so he's going to come and he's going to share a lot about like early church history in Africa and various other things that we don't always have access to that kind of information, and that is really meaningful to a lot of students who are struggling with, like, is Christianity for me? Like, is this for me? Do I have a place in this? And so if you could be praying with me for those two events that are going to be coming up on campus, that students who we don't know would be coming, that we would get connected to even more students and more students would get to hear about who the Lord is, and our group of students that is just eager and excited and glowing with growing in the Lord and getting to know him, that that would just continue to grow and more students would get to know Jesus at Harris Stowe. Thank you.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a God of not just David and Israel, but a God of throughout all of history. And you kept your promises to them of the coming Messiah. And through Christ, we have a great high priest who sacrificed himself for us. And you also keep your promises that he is coming again, and may we look forward to seeing him in that day. Lord, thank you for all the work that is going on at Harris Stowe. Thank you for the work of Aaron and Brittany and Emily and how you're using them to speak your truth, to speak love to the students there, and how you are opening hearts and minds to the gospel. I give you thanks for the winter conference and how that impacted Jada and many others. And I pray that you would continue to direct their paths as they seek to know you better, to study you, and to spread the good news that is found in Christ. Lord, I pray for the tough questions night coming up. I pray that that would be a time where students can really bring questions that they're wrestling with of faith. And I ask that you would give the panelists and speakers wisdom and speaking truth. Lord, I pray for Carver and the teachers there at Carver Elementary. I ask that you give them wisdom and strength in a tough time of the school year, and that they would be able to finish strong, and that they would be able to do well in teaching in sometimes a difficult circumstance, and that they can open hearts and minds to the wonders of your world and who you are and your creation. Father, I pray for Aaron as he comes to bring us your word. Lord, I thank you for the book of Deuteronomy and the beauty of your law. And I pray that you would speak through Aaron this morning. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
All right, let me have the children come up.
Mama told me before you said it.
She did. All right. All right, don't pull on the table, y'all. Don't pull on the table. All right, adults, we send our kids away by saying,
"The Lord be with you."
And also with you.
I'll ask me later, okay? All right, I'm gonna switch to, is this mic working? All right, y'all can hear me in the back well? All right, we're in Deuteronomy chapter 31 this morning. This morning we want to look at verses 14 to 29 of Deuteronomy chapter 31. We are quickly approaching the end of our series on Deuteronomy, on the book of Deuteronomy. I'll plan to have us look at verses 14 to 29 in a few minutes. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. lived at a point in our nation's history where African American skepticism regarding whether or not America would ever exhibit racial equality was both completely understandable and justifiable that Black Americans would have such a skepticism. And yet, Dr. King was a deeply hopeful man. He wrote in one place, or he's actually spoke in one place in one speech of his, he said, "May I say in conclusion that in spite of the difficulties ahead, in spite of the fact that we must work hard, I still have faith in the future. And I still have faith in America because I love America. And I believe that we will continue to build a coalition of conscience that one day will solve this problem." Dr. King, in the midst of all that was going on, said he had faith in the future, faith in America, and that he believed that this problem of racial injustice would one day be solved. And in his last speech, given the day before he died, the day before he was assassinated, Dr. King said this, "Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain, and I've looked over, and I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land." Dr. King was hopeful about our nation's moral future in race relations, even likening himself to Moses, going up to the promised land, knowing that he can't go in, but saying that we will get there. But the actual historical Moses, the Moses of the Bible, when it came time for him to die, was actually not so sure about his people's moral future once in the promised land. Actually, scratch that. He was sure about it. He was sure that once he died and the Israelites entered the promised land, that they would go astray and provoke God to wrath. And Moses' conviction about the future, unlike Dr. King's, was not what he simply thought might be true or looking at current trends, but it was what he knew would be true about the future because he was a prophet. And God had revealed to him exactly what the future would hold for the Israelites. If you would, read with me from Deuteronomy chapter 31, verses 14 to 29. And Moses says, And the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, the days approach when you must die. Call Joshua to present yourselves in the tent of meeting that I may commission him." And Moses and Joshua went and presented themselves in the tent of meeting. And the Lord appeared in the tent in a pillar of cloud. And the pillar of cloud stood over the entrance of the tent. And the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, you are about to lie down with your fathers. Then this people will rise and whore after the foreign gods among them in the land that they are entering. And they will forsake me and break my covenant that I have made with them. Then my anger will be kindled against them in that day, and I will forsake them and hide my face from them, and they will be devoured. And many evils and troubles will come upon them, so that they will say in that day, 'Have not these evils come upon us because our God is not among us?' And I will surely hide my face in that day because of all the evil that they have done, because they have turned to other gods. Now, therefore, write this song and teach it to the people of Israel. Put it in their mouths, that this song may be a witness for me against the people of Israel. For when I have brought them into the land flowing with milk and honey, which I swore to give to their fathers, and they have eaten and are full and grown fat, they will turn to other gods and serve them, and despise me and break my covenant. And when many evils and troubles have come upon them, this song shall confront them as a witness. For it will live unforgotten in their mouths of their offspring. For I know what they are inclined to do even today, before I have brought them into the land that I swore to give. So Moses wrote this song the same day and taught it to the people of Israel. And the Lord commissioned Joshua, the son of Nun, and said, "Be strong and courageous, for you shall bring the people of Israel into the land that I swore to give them. I will be with you." When Moses had finished writing the words of this law in a book to the very end, Moses commanded the Levites who carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, "Take this book of the law and put it by the side of the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, that it may be there for a witness against you. For I know how rebellious and stubborn you are. Behold, even today, while I am yet alive with you, you have been rebellious against the Lord. How much more after my death? Assemble to me all the elders of your tribes and your officers, that I may speak these words in their ears and call heaven and earth to witness against them. For I know that after my death you will surely act corruptly and turn aside from the way that I have commanded you. And in the days to come evil will befall you, because you will do what is evil in the sight of the Lord, provoking him to anger through the work of your hands." This morning, I would like for us to consider 4 points. First, God was faithful to Israel. Second, Israel was faithless to God. Third, we have been faithless to God. And fourth, God has been faithful to us. So first, let's consider God was faithful to Israel. And God was faithful to Israel both in their past, and he would be faithful to Israel in their future. But first, let's talk about their past. And there's so many things I could talk about how God was faithful to Israel in their past. But let's just focus on the area of leadership and deliverance. First, leadership. Take a look again at verse number 14. "And the Lord said to Moses, 'Behold, the days approach when you must die. Call Joshua and present yourselves in the tent of meeting, that I may commission him.' And Moses and Joshua went and presented themselves in the tent of meeting." Brothers and sisters, good leaders are a gift and a blessing to a people. When leaders are good, the people generally flourish under their leadership. But because of sin in a fallen world, finding good leadership is often hard. Because human beings and our sin, so often when we get a little bit of power, we get a little bit of authority, we use that authority so often to lift ourselves up as opposed to lifting up those who placed us in leadership. God gave the Israelites a good leader, Moses. Now, Moses was unlikely to be a good leader for the Israelites, or unlikely to lead them well for many different reasons. I mean, ethnically, Moses was like the Israelites. He was an Israelite, but culturally, he was very much not like them. You see, the Israelites were a nation of slaves at that point in time, but Moses, he grew up in Pharaoh's court. He was spoiled. Probably not likely to be able to connect well with them. But even more importantly, morally, Moses was a compromised man before he came to leadership. Do you remember that Moses, in his anger, murdered a man, killed a man? How many of you would like a convicted murderer to be your leader? But even after Moses goes away for 40 years, when it's time for him to enter into leadership, when God calls him, Moses is not ready. At least Moses thinks that he's not ready. Moses was fearful and he felt inadequate when he was called to lead God's people. God said, Moses, come, I'm going to be with you. Go to Pharaoh, tell him to let my people go, and I will be with you. And Moses said, God, I'm not eloquent. I don't know how to speak. Maybe you should send someone else. And God said to Moses, who made man's mouth? God is like, I can teach you to speak. And then after that, Moses just simply basically begs God and says, God, please send someone else. And after that, God's wrath burned against Moses. And he said, you see Aaron over there, your brother? Go, speak to him. Tell him the words, and he'll speak on your behalf, but go. So Moses, at the moment of crisis, at the moment when leadership was ready, he was fearful, he felt inadequate. Nevertheless, this Moses would go on to successfully challenge Pharaoh. He would go on and he would be successful. He would challenge Pharaoh. He would lead the Israelites out of Egypt. And then when it came time, when the Israelites were in the wilderness, after God had led them through the wilderness, through Moses, then when Moses went up on the mountain, was getting the very commandments from God, the people were down low, worshiping a golden calf. And God says to Moses, I'm about to wipe them out, Moses, and I'll make a great nation out of you. And what did Moses do? Moses didn't say, oh man, that's a great plan. Instead, he falls down, or maybe he stands up. I don't know what posture he was in, but he cries out to God, and he says he intercedes on behalf of Israel. He intercedes for their survival. And God, because of Moses, spared the nation of Israel. Moses was a successful leader. He faithfully taught God's people. He was said to be faithful in all of God's house. The Bible says that when God spoke to Moses, he spoke face to face like a man speaks to his friend. Moses was a gift from God. Moses was successful, but ultimately Moses' success wasn't really because of how great Moses was. It was because God was with him as he led God's people. Moses was successful because God was faithful to Israel. But not only in the area of leadership do we see God's faithfulness, we see God's faithfulness in the area of deliverance. Remember who the Israelites were just 40 years before this passage of scripture that we read. R.A. hinted at it. The Israelites was a nation of slaves. They were not a mighty nation. They weren't a mighty nation economically. They weren't a mighty nation militarily. They weren't a mighty nation numerically. They were slaves. They were oppressed. They were forgotten by the world in the midst of a mighty nation, but God. But God did not forget them, though the world may have. And God saw this nation of people forgotten, and yet he chose to set his love upon them. And why did he set his love upon them? Was it because they in some way brought prestige to God because they were so great? No. Like I said, in many ways, they weren't. But also morally, they weren't. It wasn't like they were a morally superior nation, and that's why God set his love on them. Not at all. Listen to Deuteronomy chapter 9, verse 4 and 6. Moses says to the Israelites, do not say in your heart, after the Lord your God has thrust them out before you, it is because of my righteousness that the Lord has brought me in to possess this land. Whereas Moses says, it is because of the wickedness of these nations that the Lord is driving them out before you. And then in verse 6, he says, know therefore that the Lord your God is not giving you this good land to possess because of your righteousness, for you are a stubborn people. So it was not because Israel was a morally superior nation that God says, oh, this would be a great people for me to connect myself with. God simply, in his mercy and in his love, set his grace upon them. And they were greatly privileged as a result. They had a relationship with God that no other nation could claim. What other nation could say that the creator of the universe came to us and worked miracles on our behalf and delivered us from a mighty nation, splitting seas that we may walk through them and drowning their enemies? What other nation could say that they were led by a cloud and a fire representing the presence of God? What other nation could say that? Israel survived and thrived by the mighty grace of God because God was faithful to Israel. But not only was God faithful to Israel in their past, he would be faithful to Israel in their future. Again, consider the area of leadership. Take a look at verse number 23. And it says, "And the Lord commissioned Joshua, the son of Nun, and said, 'Be strong and courageous, for you shall bring the people of Israel into the land that I swore to give them. I will be with you.'" At the time of our passage, faithful Moses is about to die. Now, can you imagine how scary that must have felt for the Israelites? They had, since they came out of Egypt, they had only had one leader. And that leader was a great leader. That leader spoke face to face with God for them. That leader worked miracles through the power of God on their behalf. And yet, they are about to face the challenges of going in to conquer a land, and that leader is about to die? They must have been a little scared and intimidated. But God would raise up for them another faithful leader, Joshua. And as God was with Moses, so God was going to be with Joshua. It would be this Joshua who would lead Israel into battle. And God would give him victory for their sake. In one battle, we are told that five nations and five kings gathered against Israel in the land. And Israel was outnumbered. But yet we're told that God fought on behalf of Israel. And he sent down huge hailstones. Says that more men were killed from the hailstones than were killed in the battle by the Israelites. And on that day, Joshua did something pretty crazy and pretty outrageous. He prayed to God, and he said, "God, cause the sun to stand still." He wanted the sun to stand still because Israel was winning in the battle, and he didn't want it to become nighttime and they have to stop. And the scripture says that God listened to him. And it says in Joshua 10:14 these words, it says, "There has been no day like it before or since when the Lord heeded the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel." You see that? That verse says that God did something on that day that he had never did for any other person, not even for Moses. God listened to Joshua's voice, and the sun stood still for almost a day. God did it because God was faithful to Israel. He was faithful also in the area of land. Consider verse number 20. Or he would be faithful to Israel in their future in the area of land. So leadership and now land. Verse number 20 says, "For when I have brought them into the land flowing with milk and honey, which I swore to give to their fathers, and they have eaten and are full and grown fat, they will turn to other gods and serve them and despise me and break my covenant." God would be faithful to Israel in the area of land. Notice the description of how well the Israelites would have it in the land. It is said that it's going to be a land that is flowing with milk and honey, which means that the land that God was going to give Israel was going to be a rich land. It was going to be an abundant land. It was going to be a delightful land. And again, remember who this promise is being made to. God is making this promise of such an abundant land to a nation that has not had their own land for over 400 years. All of them don't know what it's like to have their own land. They have been slaves, but yet God is saying, I'm going to give you your land, and it's going to be abundant. It's going to be a blessing. Because God was faithful to Israel, and God will be faithful to Israel in their future. And we see all the more God's faithfulness to Israel when we consider that God was promising them this abundant land even after their rebellion in the wilderness. Though they had rebelled, God says, I'm still going to bless you. Children of God, it's a huge blessing that God so often does not deal with his people as their sins deserve. Psalms 103, verses 10 and 11 says this, he does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. Man, that is good news. If God was not such a merciful God, we would not even be able to coexist with him. If he was just a God of justice, we would be done. But our God is a God of mercy. But despite all of God's faithfulness to Israel, Israel was faithless to God, both in their past and in their future. Take a look at verse 27. Moses says, for I know how rebellious and stubborn you are. Behold, even today, while I am yet alive with you, you have been rebellious against the Lord. How much more after my death? Moses says that the Israelites, even in spite of all that they had witnessed through him, the parting of Red Seas, water coming out of rocks, the drowning of enemies, bread literally falling from heaven. After all of that, Moses says, you've been stubborn all along. Even though no other nation had it so good, it's very likely we could say no other nation has sinned against God so wickedly in the face of such goodness. You remember there was the golden calf incident. There was the grumbling in the wilderness. On one occasion, the Israelites even wanted to stone Moses. Then when God told them, go ahead in the promised land, I'm with you, I'm gonna give you victory, they refused to go. So often, gratitude and trust did not inspire obedience within the Israelites, though it should have. But not only was Israel faithless in their past, they would be faithless in their future. And we're told that they were going to turn to idols. Verse number 16, when they get in the land, Moses says, in the future, you're going to turn to idols. Verse 16, and the Lord said to Moses, behold, you are about to lie down with your fathers. Then this people will rise and whore after the foreign gods among them in the land that they are entering, and they will forsake me and break my covenant that I have made with them. Moses says, God tells the Israelites that in their future, they were going to turn to idols. And notice in that verse, the image of adultery that's kind of implied in that verse, right? It says that the Israelites, after Moses died, was going to rise and whore after other gods. And then it says that they were going to break the covenant, like the marriage covenant. Israel was going to commit spiritual adultery. And they were going to commit adultery against the perfect spouse. And that's exactly what happened. Israel went into the land. And they ended up turning to other gods. They turned to other gods because they refused to drive out the nations that God said. He said, drive them out, otherwise you're going to be led into idolatry. But they refused to do it. They fell into idolatry because they began to intermarry with the nations. When God said, do not give your sons and your daughters to the nations. And they did. They ultimately fell into spiritual idolatry because they refused to separate themselves from the world. And then also consider that even though God was going to give them the good gift of the land, Israel would misuse it and the land would draw them away from him. Verse 20, "For when I have brought them into the land flowing with milk and honey, which I swore to give to their fathers, and they have eaten and are full and grown fat, they will turn to other gods and serve them and despise me and break my covenant." The land was going to be good, but the people were going to take the creation over the creator. Life was going to be good in the land. God was going to give them a good land, and they were going to let their wealth and let their comfort draw their hearts away from faithfulness to the Lord. And over Israel's history as a nation, God would send prophet after prophet to call them back. To call them back to the covenant because he was faithful to them. He was patient with them. He would be extremely patient. He sent the prophet Hosea, and Hosea came and cried out against the bloodshed in the land. He sent the prophet Amos, and Amos came and cried out against the mistreatment of the poor in the land. He sent Micah, and Micah came and cried out against the leaders taking bribes. He sent Ezekiel, and Ezekiel came and cried out against the misuse of power by the leaders. He sent Malachi, and Malachi came and cried out against the Israelites' mistreatment of their wives. He sent Jeremiah, and Jeremiah came and cried out against their sacrificing their children as offerings to false gods. He sent Isaiah, and Isaiah came and cried out against the stupidity of idolatry. And then he sent the Messiah, and of him they begged the Romans to hang upon a tree. Though God had been faithful to Israel, Israel was faithless to God. And God's judgment would come upon Israel throughout their history for these things. And yet, even to this day, God stretches out his hands to Israel, promising them mercy if they would but return to him through faith in their Messiah. But what about us this morning? You see, we too have been faithless to God, both in our past and we will be in our future as well. Brothers and sisters, we can't throw shade at Israel this morning because their history is in many ways our history. God has been good to us, and we have so often rebelled. God, even before you became a Christian, you had a God-given conscience, and yet we rebelled. All of us before Christ were dead in our trespasses and sins. Our minds were at enmity with God. We suppressed God's truth in unrighteousness. Before Christ, we followed after the course of this evil world. Satan was our father, and our minds were blinded by him. And none of us were righteous, no, not one, and there was no fear of God before our eyes. In our past, we sinned against a faithful God. I've been thinking about a young lady, and the thought of her actually haunts me. Her name is Tia Morrison, and I deserve hell for my cruelty to Tia Morrison in elementary school. Though I had a God-given conscience, I tormented Tia with my friends, frequently telling her as many times as I had opportunity that she was ugly. And I have a little daughter now, and in my flesh, I would want to hurt some little boy who did to her what I did to Tia. Forgive me if I'm being too honest, but in my flesh, that's what I would feel. I have wondered psychologically if the wounds that I caused and my friends caused her, if they still haunt her to this day. I've sought to find her on Facebook to apologize, but couldn't find her. I recently prayed that she would have a husband that cherishes her and tells her how beautiful she is to him. Brothers and sisters, my mistreatment of Tia was an expression of my faithlessness to my and her Creator. We all have been faithless to God in our past, but brothers and sisters, not only have we been faithless to God in our past, we will be faithless to God in our future. I wish I could tell you that a Christian's sin was only past tense, but it's not. We who have the Spirit still rebel, egregiously so at sometimes. And if God continues to give me breath, one thing that I know for sure about my future is that I will sin in my future. I wish it was not the case, but I know that God will quite often in my future see my expressions of pride, my selfish ambition, my harshness, my ingratitude, my impatience, my prayerlessness, my doubt, my anger. And the list could go on and on. Children of God, we have been and we will be faithless to God. But friends, though we have been and will be faithless towards God, let me close by reminding you that God has been and will be faithful to us. You see, in the past, even before you were born, even before God created the world, if you are in Christ today, you're in Christ because God chose you, because God elected you. Even before you committed your first sin, God chose to set his love upon you and place you in Christ. Because why? Because there was something good about you, something morally superior, something better? No. Simply because he loved you. But not only did God set his love upon you in the past, way in the past before creation, God, at a certain time before you were born, stepped into time. And he came for you. Even before you committed your first sin, even before you were born. But when he came in time, he came with a view to all the sins that you were going to commit. And he lived the life that you could never live, and he died the death that you deserved to die. And he allowed himself to be hung on a cross for you. So that when you would believe in time, you would get his righteousness. He took your sin back then so that you could have his righteousness right now. Those are some things he's done in the past. How about even in the past, other things such as how many times, Christian, has he answered your prayers? He's given you the gift of his Spirit. Already in the past, you have experienced his guidance, his provision, his protection. And so forth and so on. So, child of God, I encourage you this morning to see and savor the grace that God has shown you since you have been a Christian. And even before you ever became a Christian. Rejoice that your worst sins, the sin that you've committed that you don't want to tell anybody about, that sin cannot condemn you. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And out of gratitude for the mercy and sure forgiveness of God, I encourage you to live for God. Stop living for yourself. Live for God. The Apostle Paul said in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. And so, Midtown Church, I appeal to you on behalf of the mercies of God that you have already experienced to live for God. But not only has God been faithful to you in the past, he will be faithful to you in the future. If the Lord gives you breath in your lungs, one thing you can count on about the future is not just your sin, but God's faithfulness. You too will experience his ongoing forgiveness when you cry out to him in your future. You will experience answered prayers when you look to him in faith. You will experience his guidance and his favor. And yes, out of love, even his discipline in your future. But not only that, as you look further into the future, God has a promised land for you that is reserved for you. Just like God had a promised land for the Israelites, the Lord God has a promised land for all his people who are in Christ that will be better than the promised land that Israel had. Theirs was flowing with milk and honey. Where we're going, it says that the streets are of gold. But even more importantly than that, the very presence of God will fill the whole place from beginning to end. You will experience the presence of God more than you ever have, even at your highest spiritual moment in this life. It says, at his right hands are pleasures forevermore. And in this, and at this promised land, guess what won't be there? Your sin won't be there. God will take away your sin, and you will experience emotions untainted by sin. Can you imagine that? Your mind will work and understand things in ways that you've never have experienced, because sin will not affect your mind. Your bodies will be glorified. And in that eternity, you will have a never-dying joy, because we will be a never-dying people. Joy forever and ever and ever. So to all of you who trust in Christ this morning, I am happy to report that as it pertains to that heavenly promised land, I will get there with you. And you will get there with me. And we as a people will get to the promised land, because God is faithful. Amen? Amen? Amen. Let me close this in prayer. Lord God, who are we that we can have such promises on our lips? And it not just be talk, but that it will be a sure reality, because it is purchased already by the blood of Jesus. Who are we that we should have such good things? The better question, oh God, is who are you? Because it's only because of you that we can have such promises. And we give you thanks and we give you praise for being faithful to us, even when we have been faithless. And we thank you for your kindness to us in Christ. And it's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Amen. Let us make a circle for communion.
On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he gathered with his disciples, who were like Israel and like us. They were faithless. They were a faithless group. God didn't choose them because they were better than anyone or smarter or funnier or more theologically correct. We don't know why he chose them. We don't know the reasons, but we know he chose them for the same reason that he chose us, those who are his, is because he loved us and he intended that we would be a part of his kingdom. And that's the future that Aaron has spoken about. And until that time, for those of us who have been chosen like his disciples, he has a meal for us that we celebrate every week, a reminder of our past and a reminder about our future, because we take this meal in anticipation of Jesus coming again in the clouds. Let me pray. Father, we thank you that you give us reminders, you give us your word, and you give us this meal, this little taste of the feast that is yet to come, of your mercy, of your faithfulness, despite our faithlessness. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. This is his body that was broken for you as a reminder of his love for us. And this is his cup that is given also. It's a reminder of his blood that was shed for our sins. This is a meal that is meant for those who have believed. As a faithless person, you have believed that Jesus' faithfulness has taken care of your sin through the cross of Jesus. And if that's what you believe, then this is a meal for you. If that's not what you believe, we're honored. We're glad. Thank you for coming and worshiping. You can observe and come through the line and then join us for the final song. But come, take and eat. This is his body. This is his blood shed for you.
Yeah.
Lift now your hands to receive the benediction and repeat after me. And now unto him, who is able to keep us from falling, and who is able to present us faultless before the presence of his glory, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Amen. 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 All right. A few announcements. This Saturday at 10 a.m., Midtown Men's Hangout at First Watch in Brentwood. Midtown Together Upward is continuing. Mark, you want to say something about the
third verse?
Well, before I hand it off, one last thing is also the plug event, which is not up there. That's this Friday and Saturday. If you're interested, come talk to me.
And then this month, we're doing officer nominations for elders and deacons. So if you think you would know somebody who might you would consider worthy of being an elder or deacon, then please talk to me. There are some sheets on the back table where you get signatures of a total of five people who would affirm that and give those to me or Aaron or one of the elders. The fuller directions are on the sheets, which are on the table, and we'll go into more detail in the next few weeks, but we got the entire month to do it. So, and today is Joy's birthday. So let's sing happy birthday.
All right, go in peace.